Hello again, and thanks for visiting the mattgadient.com website. Today we're going to be taking a look at reducing the temperature coming from the Northbridge of your MSI X58 Pro-E motherboard. Now, for those joining from YouTube, if you'd like, you can visit the mattgadient.com website and read the write-up there. And before we actually get started with the how-to, we're just going to go over some of the heat issues themselves. Now, there have been a lot of reports. You Google around for this motherboard and search for IOH or Northbridge, you're going to see that a lot of people have been reporting temperatures of 80 to 90 degrees Celsius, and you'll see people are pretty worried. They're, oh no, you know, the temperature's really high, what do I do? Is my motherboard going to die? Now, Intel does state that 100 degrees Celsius is the maximum safe temperature for the Northbridge. So you are within the guidelines when you're running at 80 to 90 degrees. However, this doesn't leave you a lot of headroom. It's possible to get really close to the thermal limit, particularly if you're in a warm room or warm house, or for those people who are overclocking. And exceeding the thermal limit could drastically reduce the life of the Northbridge, and basically your motherboard. Generally, you want to try and keep things as cool as possible. Things tend to last a lot longer when they're cool. So the question becomes, what can we do to cool things down? Well, we've got a few options. The first one is you can purchase an aftermarket Northbridge heatsink. This tends to work really well. You'll actually have the best potential gains if you get a really high quality one. The downside though is it's kind of costly, and you'll have to buy a Southbridge heatsink too, because by default the North and South bridge heatsinks are linked by a heat pipe, so you've got a lot of added cost there. The second option is to replace the thermal interface pad with a quality thermal interface paste. So you can use something like Arctic Silver, OCZ makes some stuff, Cooler Master. There are a lot of good quality thermal pastes you can buy. Now there are some pretty good potential gains. You might see 10 degrees, maybe 20 degrees Celsius difference. And cost-wise, you can usually get a tube of paste for under $10. It'll last for a lot of heat sinks. And the other advantage is you might actually already have some paste around, so you might not be spending anything. The third option is to simply attach or glue fans to the existing heat sink. This can be pricey, depending on the fan that you get. The downside is a lot of the cheaper fans tend not to last very long, and they're pretty noisy. And if you need to detach the fan and the future to replace it, you might have trouble pulling it off of the glue. So not the greatest option, but a decent one. So we are going to be choosing the second one for this overview. Simply the first one is just too costly to justify for this motherboard. The MSI X58 Pro-E motherboard is one of the cheaper motherboards. And really, if you're going to be spending all the money to get an aftermarket Northbridge heatsink, you may as well just step up to a more pricey motherboard that's got a better default one built in. The third option is definitely a viable one, but it's pretty ugly, and like I said, the fans can be kind of noisy, so we're not going to do that one. So now that we know what we want to do, let's figure out how we're going to do it. So first up, we're going to identify each of the heatsinks. This first one that says Dr. Moss is for the MOSFETs. You're going to be leaving this one alone. I ended up taking it off and replacing stuff, but I'll mention why later, why you might want to just leave it alone. Now you'll see in the top, kind of moving towards the left, is the Northbridge heatsink. That's the one that's getting really hot, and that's the key one we're going to be replacing. Just above it, though, you'll see the one that says MSI's for the Southbridge, and that one is going to be coming off, and we're going to be putting some thermal paste on there, too, but it's not our biggest concern. So now you'll see that we've got the motherboard flipped around, and you'll see I'm removing the screws. Now, just again, you're removing the screws for the Northbridge and the Southbridge heatsinks, so those are the four you can kind of see towards the middle. One thing to note is that with a screw, there's also a little spring, and then there's also a little black washer. You'll see me grabbing those washers right away. Make sure you don't lose them. They're pretty small, pretty easy to drop, and if you forget to put them back on later, you might have the screw shorting out something in the case or putting undue stress on the motherboard or something like that. So be very careful when removing them, and make sure you don't lose them. Now you'll also see right away in the upper right, I will be removing the MOSFET heatsink as well. Now the big reason why I said earlier not to do this is because it uses a very thick pad, and there's a very good reason that it does. The MOSFETs are actually slightly below some of the other components, and if you take off that pad and you put the heatsink back down, that heatsink might start shorting out other things on the motherboard. That pad actually elevates the heatsink from all the other components. So you can do it if you really want to, but you're either going to have to use another pad or you're going to have to modify the heatsink, and I'll show you a little bit about that when we get to it. In the meantime, I'm just finishing, I'm trying to peel off those last two. Those last two don't peel off, by the way. Okay, now with the board flipped over, you can see I'm wiggling here. This is another area where you want to be really careful. You don't want to use a screwdriver to try and pry anything up or anything like that, or you could very easily damage the motherboard. Just carefully, you want to wiggle back and forth until you get them all off. There you'll see I just took off the MOSFET one, and now I'll be working on the others. Now you want to work on the Northbridge and the Southbridge kind of at the same time, just because if you get one loose, you might crack that heat pipe. So you want them both to kind of give at the same time. And you'll see this actually takes me quite a while. I'm going to be spending about a minute here just wiggling side to side, back and forth, up and down. Eventually it will come, but you do want to be careful. If you try and force it, what might happen is you might crack some of the die on the north bridge, which would be really bad because then your motherboard is basically a piece of garbage now. So, here you see right away I should be getting it to come a little bit loose. But you'll see it does take a lot of time. There we go. And it just popped loose. There we go. And there's the mod of the heatsink with the pad that it's got on there. And you see a little pad is stuck to the north bridge as well. Now you want to be scraping off the pad. You can probably use a fingernail or you can use a knife as well. Now here you'll see I've already put some thermal paste on both the south bridge and the north bridge after cleaning them up. One thing that I do strongly recommend is after you've put on the thermal paste, put the heatsink back on and just push it down with, you know, finger pressure, and then lift it up and make sure some of that thermal paste transferred to the heatsink. If it didn't, then you might have issues where the heat sinks aren't actually contacting anything, and when you start up the computer, things will overheat very quickly, and that would be bad. Now, once you've made sure that you've put on enough thermal paste and that the heat sinks are making good contact, installation is just the opposite of removal. Remember again to use those little black washers. Now, what I'm going to show you next is basically a little bit of the details if, for whatever reason, you are determined to replace the thermal pad for the MOSFET with some thermal interface paste. I'll just show you some of the stuff that has to be done. We're running short on time for this video, so I'll try and be quick. You'll see here that I used electrical tape to cover up all the little components around those MOSFETs. That's to make sure that there is no way the metal from the heatsink is going to touch any of them and short something out. You also want to use a thick amount of thermal paste. You're also going to see right away that I had to grind down part of the heatsink, and that is done because otherwise you are not going to get good contact. The heatsink will touch the other components. And finally, make sure that it is secured and making good contact, and you should be good to go. Now, if you've just seen the video and you're thinking, oh no, I'm not sure if this is something that I, you know, feel safe doing, please don't. Just do the method where you tape a fan to the heatsink. You'll at least get a little bit of an improvement if you tape it or glue it on. For anyone who is going to be doing this anyway, I hope this has helped you out a little bit. And for everyone else, if you'd like to read the write-up, it's available at mattgadient.com. Until next time.